One of the great hymns of the faith, Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer. Please remain standing for the reading from the
and
Gospel.
And now the Gospel.
The reading will be presented
by the Honourable
Mia Amor-Motley, QCMP,
Prime Minister of Barbados.
Prime Minister of Barbados.
Readings taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 1 to 12. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way, they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the Gospel of Christ. Praise Christ.
And now the address after the Honourable Prime Minister will be delivered by the Very Reverend Dr. Geoffrey Gibson, who is the Dean of the Cathedral of St. Michael and All Angels, and also I do believe is our lector for this morning. In this, the official service for Sir Everton Weeks.
I speak to you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. The book of Revelation, chapter 20, verse 12, reads as follows. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Also, another book was opened, the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works, as recorded in the books. End of quote. Today we celebrate the life of Sir Everton de Courcy Weeks on this historic venue, a place from which he launched his meteoric rise in the cricketing arena. His name has been firmly recorded in the annals of cricket history. After 62 years of retirement, the amazing news is that some of his records are yet to be broken. Of particular interest, I commend his 5 consecutive Test match hundreds as an achievement that should motivate contemporary cricketers. As we are celebrating his life in the context of the Christian faith, we hear too of another record book, the Book of Life. The reading which we heard earlier, Revelation 21, 1-7, falls within the context of a narrative in which the author made use of some mythological ideas of the period to convey the message that there will be a time of judgment when all people will be held accountable for their respective contribution to human affairs. The material world would pass away before judgment commenced, and the writer could only describe the event in symbolic terms and made reference to the Book of Life. A picture of the ideal Jerusalem, fortified with the presence of the Lord, emerged in which the dreams of the prophetic tradition in the books of Isaiah and Ezekiel were realized. John captured these images as he symbolically held before the faithful the view that there was eternal bliss in store for God's people. Moreover, God would be present among the people, and all the symptoms of death and decay would be removed from their experience. Happily, all could rest assured that the quality of everyone's life would determine one's ultimate destiny. Essentially, 2 things were being affirmed by John. 1, the renewal of the human spirit by the presence of God. And 2, accountability at the end of one's life. With respect to the renewal of the human spirit, all those features which threaten the quality of life would be overcome, including the sources and causes of fear, for example, ignorance. The sources and causes of death, too, would be defeated. Sickness, social and moral decay, and even death itself. Accountability refers to how someone used the gifts and skills with which one had been endowed by the end of their life. People who had developed their gifts and skills to the fullest and used them in the service of others were deemed all right. It was not a case of good deeds providing one with a guarantee for a blissful future, but rather it was the discovery of one's potential being used to the fullest to enhance the quality of the human experience. Towards that end, as we live, move, and have our being in this life, we should be more conscious that our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer of life records the type of innings we have played. Some of us will be stroke makers and score fours, or even the occasional six, while others will accumulate runs with neatly taken singles and well-judged twos and threes. The important thing is that while we are at the crease, we are called to be true to ourselves and to make our contribution to the team, the human race, selflessly, with confidence, and with due consideration for the well-being of everyone. That constitutes a well-played innings. In reflecting upon the skills and achievements of our departed brother, Sir Everton, many have attested to the innings that he played, both on and off the field. In fact, those of us who only have known him off the field have experienced a remarkable man, a man who displayed virtues which have broadened our horizons and enhanced the quality of our friendships and relationships. His innings was graced with humility, the quiet virtue, which allowed him to enjoy excellence at the highest level, but to remain conscious of his roots. He walked with royalty and feasted with knights, but he never lost the common touch. I can attest that life has certainly been boosted and enriched by the innings that he has played. Also, I've experienced him to be an affable man who could engage anyone in a fruitful conversation. During the Cricket World Cup 2007, I invited Sir Everton to serve as patron to a cricket mission that the parish of St. Leonard, the church of his baptism, was hosting. It involved teams from the villages across the parish and the Al-Falal Muslim School, and catered to 13-year-olds, mainly boys, but it also attracted a few girls as well. Sir Everton's joy was quite evident as he mingled freely among the competitors and the people of the community. There was no mistaking his satisfaction to be able to give a kind word and encouragement to the boys and girls. The smiles on their faces conveyed their delight at being in the company of one of the legends of West Indies cricket. In celebrating his life and memory, I'm thankful for those encounters. All humanity is brought within the sphere of judgment. God alone will be the umpire, the most international and independent one that anyone could find. And the third umpire is non-existent. However, divine grace stands in tension with human accountability. That is, as we fulfill our potential here on earth, God meets us with mercy and makes entries into the book of life. We thank God today for the service which Sir Everton rendered to his family, the nation, and the world. His name is firmly written in the annals of cricket, and his spirit of humility will be forever etched in the minds and hearts of millions across the world. May his legacy be a permanent source of inspiration, especially for our youth, as we strive individually and collectively as Caribbean people to achieve excellence at being the best that we can be, but always remaining humble out of an awareness that the best of life is not for self, but in the service of others. In this regard, Sir Everton's life on and off the field stands as a shining example, and we pray that many would emulate it. May he rest in peace and rise in glory. Amen. And I invite you to stand. And to join me in the renewal of the Christian faith, the creed of our baptism. Let us with confidence and hope confess the faith into which we were baptized as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and a life everlasting. Amen. Our intercessory prayers will be led by Major Lubin Maxwell.
Let us pray. We pray for those who mourn, especially his children and grandchildren, nieces and nephews, all members of the Weeks family, the cricketing fraternity, nationally, regionally, and internationally, colleagues and friends. We commemorate the departed Everton de Courcy. Let us pray with confidence to God our Father, who raised our Lord Jesus from the dead for the salvation of all. Grant, Lord, that your servant may know the fullness of life which you have promised to those who love you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Be close to those who mourn. Increase their faith in your undying love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. May we be strengthened in our faith. Live the rest of our lives in fellowship with your Son, and be ready when you call us to the fullness of life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Show your mercy to the dying. Strengthen them with hope, and fill them with the peace and joy of your presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We commend all people to your unfailing love, that in them your will may be fulfilled. And we rejoice at the faithful witness of your saints in every age, praying that we share with them in your eternal kingdom, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Hear our prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to you our brother Everton, who was reborn by water and the Spirit in holy baptism. Grant that his death may recall to us your victory over death, and be an occasion for us to renew our trust in your Father's love. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow where you have led the way, and where you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, to the ages of ages. Amen.
Next hymn is, "And all thy mercies, O my God, my rising soul's affairs, transported with the view I'm lost, in wonder, love, and praise." During the commendation, I shall be sprinkling Everton's body, his casket, with holy water, a sign that Everton was baptized in the church as we welcome him in life. So now, as we turn his body to the earth, we also sprinkled him with water, with the assurance that he remains in God's eternal presence and care. That will be done during the Lord's Prayer. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of humankind, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints. Where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Our Father.
Sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. Glory of yours now and forever. Amen. And as he said, a sprinkling to signify the baptism in the church of Sir Everton. While the Lord's Prayer, of course, was being said by the congregation. And now he will continue the commendation as he returns to the podium.
Let us commend our brother Everton to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Deliver your servant Everton, O sovereign Lord Christ, from all evil, and set him free from every bond, that he may rest with all your saints in the eternal habitations, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God forever and ever. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Everton. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. We conclude this part of the service as we sing the hymn, To God be the glory.
Thank you.
God be the glory, great things he hath done, to the musical strains of that most, I think, favorite of hymns when it comes to times like this. We witness the departure right now of Her Excellency, Dame Sandra Mason, Governor General of Barbados, assisted there by her ADC and the Chief of Protocol. And so far, because now this is the service of the, you know, the official service, and then we will continue on to the interment at Cave Hill, the University of the West Indies.
And the Prime Minister's car moves into position, MP2, the grey Mercedes, and Chief of Protocol will escort the Prime Minister.
Under sunny and sometimes rainy skies today.
It's gotten a little grey, I think, as the...
A mixture of both.
The breeze remains, however, Peter.
Yes, and some rumblings of thunder. So it's, I guess, a typical summer day.
It's a typical cricketing day.
Cricketing day, yes.
I think the late Tony Kozie said once, if you wanted to rain in the Caribbean, put three sticks on the ground and say you're going to play some cricket, and the rains will come. Director Andrew Lynch doing a masterful job as usual with the Royal Barbados Police Force Band.
Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Yes. Dean of St. Michael's Cathedral and All Angels has just delivered the benediction.